Can anyone out there hear me?
Yep, gotcha.
All right, looks like there's still a few engines that are 2s, 6s, 8s, 9s, 11s, and 12s out on calls. Does anyone know?
Engine 5 is almost back.
Okay. We'll wait a few more minutes and see if they can get in on this. I do have it recorded though, so you guys can watch it if you get called out. Did everyone get a chance to watch the recording of the original one? Did anyone not? Is anyone listening right now?
Yep. Hey, 2, 5, 8, and 14 are all out on calls right now.
Okay. All right. I'm going to give it just a few more minutes, top my coffee off, and then we'll get rolling here in a second. Just for those of you that are on, what we're going to do, just as a reminder, we're going to go through the PowerPoint again, but just kind of summarize the key points and then open it up for discussion. I'd like to have a lot of participation. I want to hear all of your questions and your thoughts on these different things we're going to be covering. I think it's going to be better if we're all involved in it, not just me talking at you guys. So please be prepared to participate and help out. Once we get done with this Teams class, which in my mind, I just kind of put a placeholder for an hour, but if it goes hour and a half, that's fine. If we get a lot of good discussion. And then our first walkthroughs are at 10:30. So we'll have to knock off it at some point to make sure we make those.
Hey, Chief Walker, Engine 1, can you guys hear us?
I can hear you.
Oh, good. Just make sure our mic's working.
I can see some eyeballs, too.
Nope, can't hear you or see Joe. You got to try again. Hey, Hey, King, I have control of the microphone today, just so you know.
At station 5?
Yep.
Okay, good. Not control of my microphone.
No, but every time I agree with something you say, I'm going to do this. Oh. Did you hear it?
No, I didn't.
God damn it.
Hey, hold on a second. I gotta make a phone call real quick to one of my companies. Stand by.
Hey, we have 2 hours and 55 slides. Figure it out.
All right, we're going to get rolling. Can you guys still hear me? I heard Agent yes. 4.
Nope.
Oh, gosh, dang it. Can you guys still hear me? I pushed a button that...
Yes.
Okay, good. Okay, so for those of you that were tuned in last time, well, I'm not going to go through the entire thing. I'm going to focus on a few things, and I'll probably be bringing up the same take-home points over and over again. A lot of it's going to be about communicating effectively, and there's going to be a lot of communication that has to happen from the strategic level all the way down to the task level and in between. So we need to be really well practiced at that and think about what communications we're going to need to make in these type of incidents. We're going to talk a lot about judgment at the company officer level. And the reason that we're focusing on that and emphasizing that is that a lot of times, because these fires are an interior fire where we have to make access to the interior before we make the area of origin, we don't have a good view out in the fire SUV sitting outside. So those of you inside are going to have to assess the situation and make some judgment calls and either lead up or bump us, help us understand what's going on, because we don't have the SAE that you'll have. So that's going to require some thought process on your part. You can't be robotic and just fall into the same pattern. If you get an assignment that just doesn't make sense, you need to be communicating that, like, hey boss, this is not this is what I'm seeing. I would recommend doing tactic B instead of tactic A. I'll talk a little bit about fire protection features again, and really want to emphasize that we know what the fire protection features are. And how to use those to our advantage, because it's not just about fire prevention. It is really has tactical implications for us, those fire protection features that are provided by building code. We'll talk about some of the difficulties of the center hall multifamily dwelling. And I won't spend a ton of time on that. And then we'll talk a little bit about tactics that we will use. We're not going to be telling you, dictating exactly how we want it to be done. A lot of that is tactical level decision making that you as company officers are better suited to determine and make. And based on your training and drilling and experience, that is how we want you to handle it. We want you guys to be well practiced and know what tools are in your toolbox. And a big part of that is how to communicate it. And the last thing we'll talk about is spotting. So let's get moving on this. Got to give credit to Forrest Barnard. This PowerPoint was essentially the template was his. He put this together for his train officer test. And from what I hear, he knocked it out of the park. He did a phenomenal job. A lot of work went into it. Really good job. I, of course, took it and modified it a little bit, but he deserves a lot of credit. Learning objectives, those are not exactly the same for this summary review. Why multifamily dwellings? Well, it's not an everyday event around the country, but they're common enough an incident that they weren't looking at. They 29% of all structure fires are in multifamily dwellings. So they happen enough that it's something that we're not preparing for that once in a lifetime, you know, airplane that crashes into the school bus and turns into a hazmat and you know, some crazy scenario. These happen on a fairly regular basis. And when you look at Boise, our statistics line up pretty close with the national statistics. So 16% of all of our structure fires. And in a 4-year period, I don't know if this statistic is right. I should have Hummel verify this, but for his EFO paper, he did a study of, went back and reviewed all of our structure fires in a 4-year period. And I thought there was over 100 multifamily dwelling fires in that time period that he examined. So, I know it was about 1.5 per month is what it seemed to be. And what really I think is worth noting and what warrants looking at these is that it's common enough that we're going to see these. We're going to go on these on a somewhat regular basis. And of all of the incidents we go to, this is one of the ones that has the highest life hazard potential. Compared to other incidents. And that life hazard is one, the occupants, because it is a multifamily dwelling. As the name implies, there's a lot of people in the building, but also the life hazard for firefighters. We're putting our members in a pretty vulnerable position every time they make entry, because from the time they make entry till they make the fire area, they are in oftentimes a bad spot. And some of that can be mitigated with decisions we make. But it's a lot more, you're a lot more vulnerable than being able to step in the front door of a single family dwelling with the living room on fire and hit it from the doorway. We've got to travel down the hallway and we get flow path issues. If we have any kind of wind event, then it becomes a pretty serious thing. Multifamily dwelling types, you guys all know these. We're focusing on center hallway. Center hallway essentially just means that, unlike a lot of the other garden apartments, we can't access them from the exterior. We have to go inside into a hallway that may or may not be tenable. Fire may have taken control of the hallway. So that, again, is putting our folks in a vulnerable spot. Era. So there are implications to Arrow. We've got, you can see, I believe that is the, it's the Walker Apartments on the top. And that is, I don't know, some new modern one. I can't remember the name of it, on the bottom. And the Arrow has a big impact on how we approach these, because there's going to be different differences in the construction methods and also the fire protection features. So remember the Arrow, and those of you that have taken Art of Reading Buildings know that we really focus on the Arrow because that really changes the game. If I talk about a ordinary construction, than a modern ordinary constructed building that was built, you know, in the 1990s, 2000s. So we need to be aware of those era differences. But one of the big things, besides the construction methodology that's used, there's also going to be differences in fire protection features. The construction type, I believe we have every construction type represented here in Boise. Not sure about heavy timber for Center Hall multifamily dwellings, but all the others. So we've got a fire resistive, non-combustible, we have ordinary, and we have wood frame. So all of those different construction types are represented here in Boise with their own, you know, particulars and nuances that we have to think about. Obviously, when we think about building construction, we think about era. And if it's an older building, remember, you've got mass over math. They've got, there's more sturdy buildings, tend to hold up better over under fire conditions. But there's also disadvantages to older buildings. Usually the fire protection features are not as robust. If they do have fire protection features, oftentimes they've been degraded over time and maybe aren't going to, your fire partition is not going to withhold, stand up and resist fire the way it did originally, or the way a modern one would work. So fire protection features, this is one of the items I want to cover a little bit more today. It was built with the standards of the time, what code dictated at the time of construction. And as things improved, fire code improved over time. And not only did fire code improve, but adoption and enforcement improved over time. Meaning it's up to the jurisdiction to adopt the code and then actually enforce it. And we've got a lot of areas in our jurisdiction that were under the purview of either unincorporated Ada County or fire districts like Whitney or North Ada County. And it's likely that even if they did adopt the building code at the time, they may not have had the staffing to enforce it. So those of you that are in areas that were built up outside the city limits, so places like Eights and Nines, where you had a fair amount of growth in that area, a lot of those areas were built up before they were under the city's jurisdiction. So it's going to be a crapshoot on what you get for as far as code adoption and enforcement. So the era will make a difference in what kind of fire protection features you have, but also the occupancy type. So generally, the more risky the occupancy type is. So you guys all know assemblies. We have a lot of people stepped into a building. Those tend to be pretty serious. The code fire protection features. When we talk about multifamily dwellings, these fall into the R category, so R1 through R4. You don't need to know that stuff other than R1 is going to be like hotels, motels. Those are transient use. That's the highest in that category. R2 is going to be more like apartments. So and I do want to make this distinction. Transient use, a hotel, the reason that is considered a higher hazard is because it's transient use, meaning people don't live there on a regular basis. And what's the implication of that? If you don't live in a place, you're just staying there for a night or two, why would that be more of a hazard for that occupant than, say, an R2, an apartment building? Anyone?
Common ways out that they usually take.
Exactly. They're not familiar with the exit paths. They probably, unless you're a firefighter, you probably don't look at the escape routes that are posted everywhere in the hotel on how to get out. You didn't pay attention to where the stairway is, and they're not always in a predictable spot. They're not always at the end of the hallway. Sometimes they're, you know, in weird spots. So what happens is fire happens and an occupant says, I'm going to make a break for it. I'm going to go for it. They get out in the hallway and try and find the door to the stairs. They can't find it. And then they get overcome by smoke. So I would guess you'd probably have a higher probability of finding people in the hallway in a transient use type multifamily dwelling like a hotel than in a an apartment building. But it could also happen in an apartment building too. And Vinnie Dunn talks about that's where we find a lot of the victims between on that path from the fire area to the exit door. So, and that's, we find that in every type of occupancy. Let's talk about specific fire protection features that I think are important and have implications for us, not just with multifamily dwellings, with a lot of different occupancies, but these are the ones that I think multifamily dwellings, probably these ones are in particular important in these types of occupancies. So we'll talk about fire separations. We'll talk about auto closing doors, protected stairwells, egress requirements, sprinklers and alarm systems. Oops, hold on, this is my place. So we talk about fire separations. Fire separation is just it's a wall or ceiling or some other type of member that is trying to separate one area from another. The idea is compartmentation of the building. The more we can compartmentalize a building and a fire area, the better it's going to be for the occupants and for us. It keeps the fire from growing unimpeded. It limits not just the spread of fire, but it limits how much oxygen that fire can get. The most beefy and most significant fire separation is the firewall, which are generally 3-hour walls. And in code, a lot of the code people talk about this, the intent is essentially separate the building into two completely different fire areas, or almost like it's two different buildings. So if I can make it from the area that's involved past the firewall, they consider it almost like you made it outside. You made it out of the building that's on fire, even though it's really connected. So firewalls, from there you have fire barriers, which there's some small nuances you don't need about that. But fire partition, that is the basic envelope that surrounds all of the living space. And going back to the beginning of fire code, fire partitions were required. A 1-hour fire partition was required around the envelope of every living space. So the room of origin should have sheetrock. If it's old enough, it's probably going to be lath and plaster that will protect fire, stop the spread of fire through that partition for a certain amount of time. Now, the older the building is, especially if it was lath and plaster, we know that that breaks down over time. So it's not going to function as well as it was originally intended, but it should give us some time that it keeps the fire compartmentalized, which is going to be important. We're going to talk about that here in a bit. When you have a firewall, again, it's separating the building into two different fire areas. Well, you can't just have a wall that you can't get from one side to the other. So you don't want to force people to walk outside to get to the other side of the building. So they allow fire doors, which function essentially, it's an opening in that firewall, but it functions the same as the firewall. So it has to have that 3-hour rating. And one of the critical things to understand is this is a fire rated assembly, meaning it's not just the door. It's the door, it's the hinges, it's the latching mechanism, it's the door jamb and the seal around the door. They have to work together as one unit to stop the spread of fire. And they also will limit the spread of smoke too. And they do a pretty good job if the assembly was installed properly, maintained, and wasn't compromised in one way or another, for example, by forced entry. So you can see this fire door here, the fireside, heavy fire involvement. The other side looks pretty darn good, right? So that would be a pretty good barrier to protect people that are on the clean side of that fire door. Keep that in mind. Stand by 1 second. I need to pause. Stand by. I'm trying to figure out how to do that. Let's see. Oh, here we go. Okay, done. All right, so fire doors. Understand what they do, understand their assembly. The assembly works as a bunch of parts together. And we are going to, I want you guys to think about, these are a very critical tool for us that we can use to our advantage when we're looking at tactics and strategy. Let's move on to fire and draft stopping. We've talked about this quite a bit, so I probably don't need to spend a ton of time talking about it, but in or above every two dwelling units, whichever are smaller. That's important to know because that will give you some predictability about where to find those. So especially you truck companies, if we want top floor fire, we want vertical ventilation, you need to know about draft stopping and where to look for it. Understanding that concept there, where you're gonna find it. And it's gonna be contiguous with an interior wall. So they wouldn't be just randomly put, you know, up above the middle of the living room. It will be concurrent with one of the walls that separates every two dwelling units. The way it works, besides the fact that it does stop the spread of fire, it also limits the draft or the air that can come in and allow the fire to grow. So if the draft stopping is in place, intact, doing its job, it will limit the amount of air that the fire can get, and it will go vent limited relatively quickly and make our job easier. Now understand, the draft stopping oftentimes is not perfect, even when it's been installed and the cable guy hasn't punched holes through it or whatever, or the building maintenance guy hasn't cut an access hole through it. There's still gonna be little tiny cracks here and there. These oftentimes are made of just OSB. And we have some pretty good pictures of fires where there was just a tiny crack between the two seams of the OSB, and you can see like a little, looks like a scorch mark where a flamethrower fire was shooting through that crack. So it does work well, but it's not going to necessarily stop the fire 100%. Because of that, we do, one of the tactics that we employ is vertical ventilation to take the pressure off of that and keep it in that area that's involved and not get past that draft stopping. Those of you that are on trucks, I've also got some other cues for you on where to look for the draft stopping. We can talk about that when we do our walkthroughs this afternoon, or you can give me a call and I'll give you some more of those little tips. Self-closing doors, this is a big one. So the self-closing door, those are mandated. Those have been mandated for quite a while in the building code. And the whole idea here is to compartmentalize the fire. And when they work properly, meaning those spring loaded hinges are operating normally, they haven't been disabled, they haven't worn out over time, it will close the door to the occupancy room and keep the fire in there. And it should be a fire rated door, so it should hold up for a while. Now, again, the older the building is, the less reliable these are going to be. And the springs will wear out. People don't want to, they're bringing their groceries back to their apartment. They don't want to have to constantly push against the spring loaded door, so they'll disable them, whatever. The fire in, is back east, not the Cherry Lane. I can't remember. The carpet that had been installed in this building was too high. It drug across the floor, or the door would drag across the carpet. That prevented the doors from closing this, and it led to a flow path that killed a fire captain on the third floor when there was a flow path. I'm sorry, I can't remember it right now. But they will fail. It can be disabling, it can be worn out. Someone can open the door and fall right there in the doorway, or drop something that keeps it open. So when we find these doors and they're open, if we can close them, and it's not just the door to the occupancy, it can be, we're also talking the doors to the stairways, to the stairwells, protected stairwells, and also the fire doors that you might find in a really long hallway. And a good example, this recent example, was the Twin Parks Northwest Complex fire back in January. 17 people died, and really, it was the failure of the self-closing doors that caused this tragedy. Fire started on the third floor. Self-closing door to the apartment did not close. Went up the stairwell. The stairwell self-closing door on the 15th floor did not close. It filled smoke on the 15th floor, and a bunch of people died of smoke inhalation. So it happens. The protected stairwell. This is probably one of the best features that was added to the building code for us, because it allows people a way to get out of the building if you're on an upper floor. And this came about, really became prominent in the code in 1946 after three high profile hotel fires where the stairwells were not protected. They were open stairwells. Fire on lower floors were allowed to burn and send smoke all the way up to the upper floors. Of course, if you have a reverse stack effect, it could be a fire on the first or on an upper floor and sending smoke down to the bottom of the building. So adding that protected stairwell was a critical feature that was added to the building code, and one that's very beneficial for the occupants, but also for us. It allows us to have a good, safe area of refuge, a good starting point for our tactics, and allow people to get out. That's why we want to identify which is going to be our fire attack stairwell and which is going to be our evacuation. We don't want, because we're probably going to end up contaminating the fire attack stairwell. We want people to still have a way out. There's been a lot of cases of this, of fires in buildings that don't have protected stairwells. If you're not familiar with the Ponant Square Hotel fire in LA in 1970, check that one out, because it killed, I can't remember, I think like 13 people. And the city, this is one of the times where they did add one. They gave them 4 years to do it, and another fire came in before that 4 year period was up. And then they said, you don't have 4 years, you've got 6 months. So if you ever hear someone talk about Ponette doors, those are doors to the stairwell, so protected stairwell. Now, I said 1946, right? So buildings before 1946, it's not guaranteed, possibly not even expected, to have a protected stairwell. And we do have buildings here in Boise that are multifamily dwellings that have open stairwells from bottom floor to top floor. And I think the guys in Battalion 1 are going to be able to see one today. So be very aware if you go in and you don't see doors, a protected stairwell, doors between the stairwell and the each floor, that's a big deal. And that needs to be communicated. And we need to, that will change our tactics and how we approach it. Alarm and sprinkler systems, no guarantee that they'll be present. The older the building, obviously, the less likely. And if it's a really old building, you might get something like what we see on the right, which is going to be pretty archaic, may not be very functional or useful for us. It might just give you a flashing light bulb or LED that has some code to it that's hard to interpret, especially in the middle of a an escalating incident. It's going to be difficult to try and decipher some of that. So unlike a modern system like what we see on the left. And remember, these modern systems, they do other things for us. So I just got a note. It's Downing Circle. Is the Downing Circle line of duty death in Maryland in 2011. That's the one where the carpet prevented the self-closing doors from closing. Anyway, the modern alarm system will do things that will help us out. Recall elevators, phase one. They'll close fire doors. They'll give a more accurate location of the fire. They may have a PA system, which can be very useful for us. So I think everyone's in pretty good habit of checking the panel and getting whatever information they can from that. I'd probably also advocate if you can notice whether or not it's got a PA system, because that could be really valuable for us. All right, let's move on and talk about the difficulties for center hall structure fires. Access, that's both interior and exterior. So exterior, just getting our apparatus into some of these complexes can be problematic. Those of you guys in 9th District, the Barton Apartments, there's room for about 2 apparatus, maybe 3 in the parking lot. You'll have access to the Alpha side, but not the Charlie side. So you won't get all sides of the building, meaning if we have to do VES or rescues from windows, there's going to be a lot of ground ladder work. Then we've got access on the interior. So interior access, we've got to go inside to actually make the fire room, which presents the hazards, like I mentioned already, putting our folks in a vulnerable spot. Another difficulty we have a high life hazard. We've got a lot of people that we either need to protect or remove. And that's going to be a decision, a judgment call that we need to make. What's the best way to protect these people? Do we try and pull them out through the interior, through an exterior window? Do we protect them in place, try and get the fire out, vent, and then bring them out? Fire spreads, also an issue. So my immediate concerns for fire spread, again, I mentioned that you've got the fire partitions in all the living areas, right? And so if fire starts in an occupancy, like maybe on a stovetop or something, where it's going to go first is the path of least resistance. So it fills the apartment and maybe it fails the window. That's where it's going, out the window, auto-exposing upward, which could be the rooms above, could be into the attic above. Right off the bat, am I worried about it spreading to the room next door on each side, the Bravo and Delta exposures? Not as much. I think we still need to pay attention to that, because and some hotels, they've got that access door. If like you and your family go on vacation, you rent 2 rooms that has that access door between. Now you will have pretty quick fire spread from one to the other if that door is open. We also need to pay attention to smoke spread, though, because the spread of smoke will can make it through to those adjacent occupancies, and it'll find its way certainly upward into the building. If it's a tall enough building, we have to think about stack effect and if it's positive or negative stack effect. But we do need to think about smoke spread and who's going to be vulnerable at that time. Fire attack, difficult because we're going to have delayed water on fire. We've got to get our hose lines in place. Access is difficult. There are going to be long stretches. And so we need to anticipate that we're going to have a delayed reaction time getting water on the fire. But there's some ways we can mitigate that. So the last thing I would say as far as the problems with it is these. I did mention that we have these every so often, but I would still consider this kind of a low frequency event, but it's high. This falls into that Gordon Graham matrix of high risk, low frequency, where you don't have a lot of discretionary time to make decisions, which means we need to train on this. We need to be thinking about this. We need to be really good at our tactics, communicating them, being proficient in employing them so that we can mitigate that time factor that we have where we don't have enough time to get things done. All right, let's move on to tactical considerations. I broke this down into three categories: addressing the life hazard, fire attack, and ventilation. We talked about addressing the life hazard. What are some ways that we can address that? This is where I would like some audience participation. What are ways we can address the life hazard and anyone? Can anyone hear me?
Your microphone broke up, Chief. Say it again.
How far back?
From when you started asking for participation.
8:30.
Okay. 8:30 a.m. So what I'm asking for is addressing the life hazard, talking specifically about the occupants, not the firefighters. What are some ways we can deal with that life hazard, protect the people?
Hey, Chief, this is Desolate on truck floor right now.
Go ahead.
So I think one thing to consider, and I'm thinking, you know, some of our hotels just in our district, you know, once we go to a potential structure fire, we identify where the fire is at. For instance, if it's like 301, okay, cool. We've identified where it's at. Maybe we recon the floor below or, you know, the first floor, we identify 101 and, you know, process elimination, we figure out like, okay, 301 is going to be directly above this. Now I reposition my apparatus to say the Bravo side stairwell, make access for fire attack in that stairwell. That's our fire attack stairwell. We're advancing lines up that stairwell. Through that, we're going to be doing a couple different things. We're going to be allowing those fire doors on the third floor to do their job, protecting that stairwell for some of the greater numbers and just reducing the threat of that, you know, that fire spread in that hallway. And then, you know, just focusing our efforts to getting that line in place, say with the truck company, maybe a second in engine or just our first engine in the truck for engine four, station four's response. And I saw engine seven say shelter in place. I think that's a great idea for the initial fire attack because that hallway where that fire door is at and also that stairwell that we're doing fire attack, I think sheltering in place, possibly depending on conditions, might be a great option so that we can aggressively focus our efforts on extinguishment. And then, you know, all of our other life hazards, once multiple, like this is going to be a multiple or, you know, multiple alarm fire, those other apparatuses can focus on, you know, maybe fourth floor evacuation above the fire down the exit stairwell and just kind of dividing that building up So I think it's super important, one, to identify the fire attack stairwell for our guys. And then other apparatus can then go on the, you know, typically there's a Bravo side. I'm thinking of the hotel here on Irving, right? Or off of Milwaukee to Hampton. And then on that Delta side stairwell, units can focus their efforts on evacuation down that stairwell, possibly with a ladder truck, or on Charlie's side with ladders. It's going to be very labor intensive for evacuation, but I feel like putting that fire out on 301 is essential, and focusing our efforts on that and then sheltering in place in that hallway that's isolated by that fire door.
Good, thank you. Yeah, you hit several things there. So we could address it with primary search. And what does that look like? Are we forcing every door in that hallway? That might be what we do. But as you said, like if we have a dirty hallway, we've got heavy smoke to the floor, and maybe high heat conditions, maybe not. Got smoke to the floor, that's still pretty hazardous for someone not in SCBA. Or is that necessarily going to be how we want to address it? Because once we force that fire rated door assembly, it is no longer a rated fire door assembly. You've compromised the assembly. It will not do the job it's supposed to do. So that is something, that's a factor you need to consider in making this decision. Can I force this door and ensure that once I find someone behind it, that they're going to be okay? If not, that may not be the answer. It may be, as you said, Phil, it could be evacuation of the floor above. It could be, we could be doing rescues from the exterior. That could be VES. And I would differentiate that from just a ground ladder rescue, that I throw a ladder to a window and I've got signs of, I've got a soot stained window. That's going to be VS, as opposed to I throw a ladder at a window where there's someone with a window open hanging out ready to go. So exterior rescue might be the answer. One of the things that I've been talking a lot about and pushing is, let's consider our aerial. Now, the aerial can't get to all sides of the building necessarily. Some of these multifamily dwellings, some of these hotels, you can. But like I mentioned, Barton Apartments, you can't. But I'm really encouraging the trucks to think about spotting your apparatus, even if it's as a secondary assignment. So you roll up and you're going to be given the assignment to come in and assist fire attack, with locating the fire and advancing the hose line, whatever. Set your aerial up for aerial operations, so that once things get rolling, if we change course, and we want that aerial put into play, we don't have to go around jockeying a bunch of apparatus to get it in the right spot. Spot it appropriately at first. And I would say if there's just not room for, if you don't have access to both sides, and I'm not necessarily advocating this, I'm toying with this idea, maybe we allowed that prime real estate for the second in truck so that they can place their aerial in the best spot for scrubbing as much of the available side of the building as we can. And so the last thing you talked about was sheltering in place. Remember, there is going to be fire partitions around all of the living spaces. There's going to be fire rated door assemblies into those units. Oftentimes you're going to be in way better, a way safer spot inside their room than trying to make a run for it through, or getting drugged through the smoked up hallway. That's going to be a judgment call. And that this is where I'm telling you guys, like, we are going to be looking to you as company officers and even crew members. I can't see what the hallway looks like. There's no way I can make a good judgment, like, oh, that's, you guys will be up there. You'll open the door like, there's a light haze. I think we can get people out. Let's try and get people out as quickly as you can. At the same time, we're conducting fire attack, or maybe You've got to weigh all these factors and then give that essay to us as the BCs down in the command rig on what the best tactic may be. There's a lot of options here. We don't want you just to be robotic and, oh, I was told to do a primary search, so I'm going to do it the way I always do it. I'm going to force every door, go in and search. Well, if you got a hallway that's got 20 rooms on each side, how long is that going to take? How many bottles are you going to go through before you actually get an all clear on the primary? It's probably going to take a while, and maybe our efforts are better spent trying to control that fire. So these are judgment calls. We expect you guys to be thinking officers and help make that determination tactically for us, since we can't actually see what's going on inside. Let's move on to fire attack.
Hey, Mike, yeah. Engine 4 has her hand up, and then I had something I wanted to add after they're done.
Okay, Engine 4, go ahead.
I was wondering if you could go kind of back to that aerial rescue. You said leave the coveted spot for the second aerial apparatus. And why would we do that?
I'm not committed to that. That's sort of a question that I want some discussion with bigger brains than mine on what they think of that. Because the first truck, oftentimes, we are going to use them in some kind of interior capacity, right? It's helping locate and isolate the fire, helping advance the hose line down the hallway. And it's likely in these, we're gonna find victims in the hallway. So that truck is going to be, you should at least be searching the hallway as you're moving down the hallway, locating the fire, advancing the hose line. If you find a door that's ajar to one of the occupancies, probably need to search that one, right? Because the smoke got in there. So, and I would say we need to search the two adjacent occupancies for sure, and the ones immediately above. The likelihood of them being able to use the aerial right off the bat for exterior rescue doesn't seem as likely as, well, the second truck might be a better choice for that. And I'm not saying that's exactly how I want it or the B-Shift BCs want it. This was a rhetorical question to generate some discussion. It seems to me, though, that second truck has a better opportunity to be given that assignment than the first truck. So, thoughts on that?
Yeah, so what you're saying then basically is you're spotting for your assignment, but we still need to leave access if we need to get to another side to scrub the building with another area, right?
Correct. And if you are... the first truck, spot for aerial operations, even though that's not going to be their primary assignment, it may be a subsequent assignment later on, like, hey, we're changing our tack, we're going to go truck 4, I want you guys to go out and start doing rescues from your aerial through the exterior. But you recognize that there is availability for the other truck to make the other side of the building, then just spot there where you've got good scrub area, let the other truck take the other side. If there's only one side of the building that's accessible, it's going to be aerial on one side and ground ladders on the other. And that's where I'm kind of thinking this would take a lot of like forethought and being really heads up that, hey, let's leave room for the second aerial. But right now, for me, that's just conjecture. That's just, a plan that hasn't been tested, and I just don't know how it's going to work. So I'm looking for feedback on what you guys think. Is it realistic?
Thanks.
Anyone have any thoughts on that? We're going to talk about spotting here in a little bit, and we'll talk a little bit more about it. But I want you guys spotting. Those of you guys that work for me know it's one of my pet peeves. when we don't spot appropriately, we don't have discipline to do it. So, hey, a question. It says I've got 5 minutes left in my meeting. Does that mean it's going to shut off, or is it just going to keep going? Anyone know?
I think it keeps going.
Okay. All right, good.
Hey, Mike, I wanted to add something about addressing life hazard.
Okay.
So I think that, you know, the points you're making add to the considerations, obviously, you know, the building construction and, again, the occupancy. Think about some of these. There's 767 Park Center, which is the independent living behind the Brookdale on 739. It's in Three's District. It's an elderly occupancy with old people with open stairwells. So when we're talking about addressing life hazard, well, first off, the resources that are going to be needed to manage that level of evacuation is going to be almost impossible, in my opinion. I don't think we're going to have them there. When you have fire, that's especially if it gets out of those rooms and extends down the hallway into the stairwell. So getting back to your point, like as the initial captains, I think it's critical you guys get up there quick and see what level of confinement we have. If it's just in a room versus just in a hallway versus into the stairwell. Because my guess is if it gets in the stairwell and moves up, we're probably going to have victims in the hallways above versus protected stairwell. We don't have that. So, you know, it's just things that we're going to have to be able to get in and identify through investigation and then make those decisions, because addressing the life hazard, if we can shelter in place and just go put out the fire, that's going to be the best day for us. Pulling people, even with the discussion what we're having that aerial being used on a Charlie side to pull people off, even with that, that's going to take a lot of coordination to make, you know, because it's not something we do very often. But anyways, I just wanted to make that point that, you know, getting that company in there to make that, get that information so we can start, you know, addressing those life hazards. So that's it.
Yeah, thanks, Wright. That's good stuff. Those of you that have worked with me, like getting ready for your captain's test and stuff like that, you know, and in the Officer's Academy, Jason Lewis and I preached a lot about, knowing what tools you have in your toolbox, what tactics, and then there's not black and white answers for when you do this or that. There's a lot of factors that you have to weigh in making that decision, and it ends up being a judgment call. Did fire get into the hallway? Did smoke get into the hallway? How much smoke? Is there a protected stairwell? What is the population of the occupants? Are they fully ambulatory, or the kind of old non-ambulatory people in wheelchairs, etc. If we're talking about, maybe we are sheltering in place, but we're going to do some exterior rescue. Ground ladders are resource intensive. I think we're pretty good. We have our department has changed our mindset. I think we are way more proactive on ground ladders. I feel like there's some reluctance to think about the aerial. But if you're doing a rescue above the second floor, I think round ladders are pretty reasonable for second floor. You can throw a lot, bang them, move them down the wall pretty quick. But then you still have to consider, who are you taking out the window? Is it a really obese person? Is it someone who's elderly and not very mobile? Is it someone who's terrified of heights? It's arguable, but I think you can get more people onto into a bucket than you can on a ladder. You know, maybe we aren't actually doing rescues. Maybe we're flying that aerial and having them recon from the exterior, looking for windows that show signs of smoke and or fire in that occupancy. And then we're making a VES entry into those occupancies, and we'll just leave the people that we can see them at the window. They're fine. There's no smoke coming out the window where they're at. And that's how we address it. So a lot of options, a lot of factors to consider. And I would highly encourage you company officers and you and crew members, firefighters and drivers to be thinking about this. And what are the factors that I'm going to weigh in making that decision? Again, you guys are going to have a way better perspective inside than we are sitting outside in the fire SUV. Any more comments or questions or thoughts on that? All right, let's talk about fire attack. So the goal is to get water on the fire as quickly as possible. We know we're going to have a delay because of the access problem, long stretches, et cetera. So I would highly recommend make sure you're getting the resources there early. You're going to need at least two engines to help with that, that fire attack line. I would guess if you're doing a stairwell stretch, maybe you can get away with one engine and the truck if it's a hallway stretch. But what are some things we can do to control the fire quickly and early to buy some time? Anyway. How about, well, you need to recon first. So we know good location of the fire. Isolate, yes. Thank you, Engine 7. So oftentimes we think, well, we got to put water on fire to control it. No, remember, a lot of these fire protection features, including the fire partitions, the draft stopping, the fire doors, they stop the spread of fire, but what else do? They also limit. Good deal. So we talk about the truck going up and help locate and isolate the fire. If you can make the involved occupancy and close the door, you've now done a lot to limit the spread of that fire and get our hose lines in place. The one that hasn't gone, it could go vent limited and be a pretty easy knockdown of the fire once we do get the hose line in place. So yeah, isolation. And I mentioned another one, we can use the PCAN. My mic keeps dropping out. Sorry about that. I've been having issues with that quite a bit. Did you guys miss what I was talking about with isolating using the fire doors to your advantage? So closing the door to the apartment, that will not only stop the spread of fire, but it may, if the window is still intact, it'll limit the amount of air it can get too. So it could go vent limited pretty quickly on us. They can, I'm guessing my mic just dropped out again there. Use the PCAN and close the door. We can, how about resetting from the exterior? So Barner did a little test. He went down and did a demo with using the deck gun down at the old train tower. And it was pretty impressive. It was able to reach the fifth floor. And remember when we're resetting, we need to have a straight stream. It needs to be as vertical as possible, bouncing off the ceiling. It has to be still. You can't be the three S's, still, straight, and let's see what's steep. So one of the things that I worry about as you get, and they pretended they had a sixth story and thought that it was still a pretty good stream as it went in the window. But the further you get, the more it's going to break up, the more it becomes more fog-like and starts pushing air. So just be aware of that. One of the downsides to the deck gun attack, and I like the deck gun attack. I've used it before on fires very effectively, but usually it requires positioning your apparatus in a very specific spot, which may be the spot, like the fire I had at the Edgewood Apartments, was the exact spot we needed to put the truck. So we forced the issue with the deck gun attack. Worked great, but then the truck was relegated to ground ladders to go to the roof. So keep that in mind. We might have other options. I'm leaning a little bit more in favor of using a hand line when we can for resetting, because you have the option to move it wherever you need. As soon as you hit that parking brake on the fire attack engine, it's probably staying put there for the whole the whole fire. And if you're not quite in the right spot, well, tough luck. If you have a hand line, you can move it around. Downside to hand line, you have limited how far, how high you can reach in the building. But resetting is definitely an option. From there, so we're trying to limit the spread of fire. Then we got to do our hose stretch operation. And what are our options? We can vertically stretch. We can stretch up the stairwell. Are you going to stretch from your engine, or are you going to assign a second in engine to be the fire attack pumper, depending on the location? Who's going to do what in that? Let's see. So from the stairwell, vertical stretch. Also a consideration, am I going to do a hallway stretch versus a stairwell stretch? Well, it depends on the conditions in the hallway. And we'll talk about this in a second. Fire doors are a consideration in that. Oh, so speaking of which, how do fire doors play into that decision? So, one second here. Now, this is a video of the resetting. I'm not going to show it. So let's take a look at the Vista. This is a building down in Fives District on Lust Street. It's a big, giant E-shaped building. And what you see is those red lines are firewalls. Essentially separates that building into three separate buildings or fire areas. And obviously, firewalls indicates there's going to be fire doors concurrent with those walls. Ideally, we would leave the fire doors intact. We wouldn't open those because it'll stop the spread of smoke from that one area to the rest of the building. But that's not always going to be the best choice. So, for instance, let's take a look at this. Let's say I have a fire right there. Well, if I come in and want to keep, I don't want to open those fire doors. Well, if I stretch to the only stairwell in that section of the building, it's 235 feet from the stairwell to that fire occupancy. That's a long ass stretch, putting our guys in a very vulnerable spot in case things go bad. We get a flow path, we have some kind of wind issue. So maybe that's not the best tactic. If I come from this side, however, it's 75 feet. I have to go through the fire door, but in my mind, that's a way better choice. Our guys are protected. First 60 feet, they're protected by the fire door. So I can actually hallway stretch right up to that fire door, charge it, open the door, go 15 feet, knock the fire down. Now, if I move the fire here, it's about 150 feet from there versus 150 feet from the other stairwell. I might choose to go to the one that's on the bottom of the screen, the first one. But I might still choose to go from this one here that I have shown because I can, again, I can hallway stretch right up to that door, charge the line, and then I'm ready. Now I've only got 75 feet to go. But the further you go away from that and closer to the bottom stairwell, the more apt I would be to go to that stairwell. So those are things, factors you need to think about. When you can, keep the fire doors closed to limit the smoke spread through the building. Remember, that's what kills a lot of people. That's what killed all the people in the fire back in the Bronx in January. So do what we can, but it's not an absolute. Any comments or questions on the fire attack section we just talked about? So we're kind of running out of time that I had allotted because I wanted to give plenty of time for discussion. Ventilation, we're not going to go into this in a lot of detail because for several reasons. One, there's it's a pretty complex topic that we could spend probably an hour talking about. And also the truck committee is currently working on tactics, and I know they're focusing a lot of energy on ventilation. So before we discuss this and maybe walk away with this is the way we're going to do it. I would like to hear what the truck committee has to say, some guidance from them. But really, we have our options are going to be horizontal versus vertical. Generally, I would say lower floor fire is going to be horizontal. If we have a top floor fire, vertical ventilation is a good option. If we don't have too steep of a pitch, some of these new hotels have huge peaks that are going to be almost impossible to cut a hole. Excuse me. Unless you have a 25 foot pike pole, you're not going to be able to poke through the ceiling and get that lift in not only the hallway, but also in the fire apartment. So, and ideally we would get lift in both. We'll open a hole in the fire occupancy, allow the fire to go up, also poke a hole above the interior hallway that allows the fire attack team to make that room much quicker, which makes it safer. It also reduces flow path issues for us. So it's a good tactic for us. On older buildings, I don't want to go a lot into this, but if you have an unprotected stairwell, fire on a lower floor, the fires and smoke is going to go out in the hallway if the door's left open, up the stairwells, and then start filling the top floor. So one of the standard tactics, time-tested, ones that were developed back east in buildings like this that happened, they had fires all the time, a hole over the stairwell gives that smoke a path of travel that protects those upper floor hallways. So you might still be able to get people out through the interior hallway, or at least minimize smoke building up and then eventually migrating into their rooms. Location of vent openings, we talked about that. And then we also have the option of pressurizing stairwells, which can help us keep the evacuation stairwell clean and counteract stack effect, et cetera. I don't really want, again, don't want to go into a ton of detail on this with the pending stuff coming from the truck committee, but if anyone has anything that they want to add or any questions, feel free. No? Okay. Let's talk about spotting. So this is a modern hotel where you can see you've got access to all four sides. So first an engine shows up and they pull up to the front to start their investigation. That's where the panel is. You've got access to the FTC there. They might position there. They go in, check the alarm panel, talk to RP, do a little recon, and they realize like, it'd be better positioned for fire attack to be on the Delta end. So maybe they reposition there. Maybe they send the second in engine there. Maybe they send the second in engine or reposition on the Bravo side. Again, your recon will tell you that. First truck arrives, because we've got access. You're probably not gonna be using your aerial. That's not gonna be your first assignment. But if you can, think about secondary assignments you might get. So spot accordingly to use your aerial if it were needed. You're gonna have an engine show up that needs to be water supply. So they need to be in there. We've got access to the Charlie side. So I would advocate, let's send the second truck there. Even if their initial assignment's not gonna be some kind of aerial operation, they're positioned to do so. So when we change our mind and we wanna use the aerial, there's not a bunch of jockeying of hose lines and apparatus to get them in the right spot. That requires some forethought of the truck officers and truck drivers. It also requires some forethought of the engines. If your engine is not engaged, if the apparatus is not needed for the operation, you don't need to be parked up next to the building. Everyone else should be parked out and walking in. And I'm not saying necessarily this far out, but park where you're not going to be in the way. All right. And that's all I have for That's all I had for the summary. Now I, you know, wanted to open it up if anyone has any questions or any discussion you guys want to go over in more detail. Chief Moore, Chief Mitchell, do you guys have anything you guys want to add? I do. Let me add one thing. I remembered when we're talking about our options for fire attack and vertical stretch, stretching up the stairwell. That's going to be something that we obviously aren't going to dictate that. We'll give you the assignment of fire attack. It's kind of up to you to decide what are you going to do. Are you going to do a vertical stretch? Are you going to stretch up the stairwell? Are you going to take a bundle in with you and start setting up your working line, have someone else bring a supply up to it? And I'll tell you, after watching my time in training and afterwards watching a bunch of drills where we were trying to get hose lines to upper floors, it's been a big mixed bag, and it's hard for me to really identify like that is absolutely the best practice, because I've seen people choose a vertical stretch and they knock it out of the park. It's super fluid, smooth, but then you try and stretch up the stairwell and it's a disaster. And conversely, I've seen people stretch up the stairwell, looks awesome. Then you ask them to do a vertical stretch and it's a gong show. And what I feel like I learned from that was it was really about knowing their tools in their toolbox. And they had been practicing one way and they were really good at it. And part of the practice is not just how you're going to do it, like mechanically, who's going to do what, where's the hose line going to be laid out. It is also about practicing the communication. If you've got a tactic in mind, you need to practice it. You cannot just do this, chalk talk it on the whiteboard, and this is going to be our plan. You got to go out and test it and practice it. And you need to practice with another company and practice that communication. So it's very clear what your intent is, what you need them to do, and it'll make it very fluid. I'm sure some of you guys that practice a lot have an idea like this is absolutely the best practice. This is what we should do. Should always take a bundle in with you. Should always have the second company bring the remainder of the hose in, or maybe the driver, whatever. I don't really care. As long as you one thing I'll say about vertical stretches is remember you do need to stretch to a place where you have good refuge if things go bad. So if you're stretching out a window on the same floor as the fire, things go bad and you retreat to where you have that hose line going out the window, are you going to be able to close the door and protect yourself from the fire? So that's a consideration to think about. Probably want to go from the floor below. You might actually, at the duck, you can go through a window in the stairwell, although the stairwell is super tight. But anyway, there's a lot of ways to skin that cat, a lot of techniques, and it's been fun over the years watching people do different ways of accomplishing it, because there's some really cool ideas, and it's really fun watching someone who has practiced well as a company, they've practiced that communication, and it's just fluid. So that's all I would say about those hose stretching operations. Chief Moore, you got anything?
No. I want to thank you for covering stuff. And for those that missed out on the first time around, this was really good review. No, I don't have anything. Thank you, Mike.
How many times did I say or
I think four.
Okay. The first one was terrible. I was saying it like every other sentence, so
there you go.
So this time was a little bit better. That was five. Chief Mitchell, you got anything?
Great job, Mike. Just wanted to let Battalion 3 companies know we're going to be at Oxford Suites, Engine 8, Engine 14, and Engine 17. 1426 South Entertainment. It's in the actual calendar. And then at 1 o'clock, we got engine 7, engine 12, and truck 7 at the Best Western on Federal Way. So, and then obviously Battalion 2 companies take a look, and Battalion 1 as well. So, thanks, Mike.
Yep. Yep. So, hey, Battalion Walker, 2. Yeah, go ahead.
I got one thing.
Go ahead.
Void spaces, drop ceilings, and things like that, as far as hallways, if you run into those things, checking ahead above you before you go, as you're going or whatever. And then also wanted to say happy birthday to Captain Darren Peterson and Captain Joseph Miller tomorrow. And then Phil's birthday is next week. So, Philly D, happy birthday.
Awesome. Thanks, Timmy. Appreciate it. Happy birthday to you guys. Battalion 2 companies, 16s, 10s, and 9s. We're meeting at Mallard Point at 10:30. And then 6s, 11s, and 4s. We're meeting at La Quinta on Emerald at 1300. Chief Moore, you want to confirm with guys where you guys are going?
Yeah, I was just pulling it up here. We're going to meet over at the Creek Bend Apartments on Colorado at, we're going to start at 1300. We're just going to have two sessions. So 5, 3, and 15, we're going to go first, and then 13 to 1430. 1500, we'll have engine 1, engine 2, ladder 5. Check, it's on the calendar. Thanks.
One last thing, I was just updated. We do have a heavy timber multifamily dwelling. The Idenhaw is heavy timber. All right. That's all I've got, unless there's nothing else. Appreciate you guys tuning in. Appreciate those of you that participated and added to the discussion. And if you have any more thoughts on this, please send me an email. And I think this is still a topic that warrants some more discussion and some more work. So you can use me as a clearinghouse on that. Okay. Thanks, guys. We'll see you out there. Have a good shift.